Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Bridge. We are happy you're here today, and I have a few things just briefly to share as I want to welcome you all here. One, it really got cold. You guys probably all know that already. But there is a warmth when the people of God gather together to worship the Lord. There's an interesting thing in church history that's happening, actually. This coming Tuesday marks the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, which is when Martin Luther posted the 95 Theses on the door and really highlighted the fact that we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, and Christ alone, for the glory of God alone. We get to celebrate and encourage the fact that the scriptures that were written long ago still ring true, and we still can have great joy from them today. The other thing that's going to be happening is several from our church experienced how God works in the country of Haiti, and they returned a couple weeks ago. And actually, before we sing, we're going to watch a video that will capture some of what they experienced in Haiti, and then we'll get to hear from some of them a little bit later and the service today. So we'll go ahead and watch that video at this time, and welcome.
Give us the love for peace, move us to brokenness. Our generosity, release from poverty. Your kingdom here and now, to the least of these, distribute what we have, that all may taste and see.
Sorrow. Good morning. Well, John Piper says often that missions exist because worship doesn't. With the heart being that if we were all worshiping God and it was leading to action in the way that we're called to, that we would just automatically live missionally as an overflow out of our hearts. And so we're going to worship this morning in hopes that it leads us out, in hopes that it pushes us to the earth to bring the kingdom of God to earth. Amen? Amen. So we're going to start this morning with a song called Glory to God Forever that the Haitians love to sing. Two of the songs that we're singing this morning are songs that we sang often in Haiti. And I was going to make you sing in Haitian Creole and then just decided, you know what, we'll sing in our language and they'll sing in their language this morning in Haiti as well. So I'm sure that there are probably dozens of churches in Haiti that are going to be singing the same songs as us this morning. So if you'll go ahead and stand, and if you'll go ahead and just greet one another, we're going to start playing, and then we'll sing together, Glory to God. Here we go.
Before the world was made, before you spoke it to be, you were the King of Kings. Yes, you were. Yes, you were. And now you're reigning still, enthroned above all things. Angels and saints cry out. We join them as we sing. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Creator God, you gave me breath so I could praise your great and matchless name all my days, so let my whole life be a blazing offering, a life that shouts and sings the greatness of a king. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever.
Sing that out. Glory to God.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Take my life and let it be all for you and for your glory. Take my life and let it be yours. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God forever.
Amen. We're going to sing Even So Come together next, but between our songs this morning, when we were in Haiti, the team that went, at the end of every day, they would give a word of the day, and I think those words express what it means to be a part of God's kingdom on earth and his body on earth, but also there's this sense of pain and brokenness that still exists, the sense that we're still waiting for the fullness of redemption, waiting for the fullness of restoration. Yeah, like that, exactly. I'm going to read some of their words in between songs, because I think as we sing this song, Even So Come, we're singing it with the sense that Jesus has come and he's offered us life, and he's offered us life to the fullest. John 10:10 says, "The thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." And so he's offering us life here, but we're going to sing about the anticipation of the life to come. Some of the words that some of the team members offered to describe their days in Haiti were beautiful, intense, moved, simplicity, universal, restoration, and also roller coaster, sadness, broken, unbroken, invited, unexpected, joy. That's what our life is, right, on this earth. It's full of all of those things. So we're going to take those and we're going to lay those emotions before the Lord now, and we're going to sing about when Jesus is going to come and come and come in the fullest. So let's sing this together. Even so, come.
All of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for the groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus.
So we wait,
for you. God, we wait, you're coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing,
even so come,
Lord Jesus, come. Even so come,
I'm telling you what, that blessed God's ears, everyone. At this time, if the kids, kindergarten through third grade, guys, I didn't say fourth and fifth, kindergarten through third grade, if you would be dismissed today to go back to your classroom, everyone. And while they're exiting, let's just say a prayer for them. Dear Lord, thank you so much for those children walking out there today. Lord, thank you for just bringing them here today so that they can hear your word presented to them in a way that they can understand and they can be part of your kingdom. Now, Lord, watch over us as we continue with the service. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. A few more words. Present, life, teamwork, blessed, full, weird moment, his, and again, beautiful. Psalm 103 says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." Sing with us, "Bless the Lord, O my soul."
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find.
Sing this out, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore.
Forevermore.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before. worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Yes, I'll worship your holy name. Lord, I'll worship your holy name.
That chorus together one more time without instruments.
And bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name.
Father, you are a good God. And so often your goodness is actually incomprehensible to us because sometimes we can't understand it in the moment because we have such a short perspective sometimes. But God, you are good. Father, help us to understand the depth of your goodness toward us. Father, help us to be able to sing that song when things are really challenging, when things are really difficult, when we're walking through extraordinary suffering. And help us to be able to sing that song when things are good, when we can see your goodness and experience your goodness, Lord. Father, we love you. Thank you for allowing us the privilege of gathering together in this place on this Sunday morning in Alton, Illinois, to sing such beautiful praises to you, Father, both individually and together as the family of God, as your children. God, we love you. We give this service to you. I pray that you would speak boldly and mightily and through Stephen and through those who are going to be sharing about Haiti, Lord, and that their speech would be seasoned with grace and truth. We give this day to you and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I think as Erica was sharing the adjectives of how people were describing their experience in Haiti, the word that stuck out to me, I think, the most was invited. I think that word has got some power because God is a God who invites. He invites us into something that we don't really have any business actually doing if it weren't for God's call and invitation to us to invite us into it. So perhaps someone invited you here to the bridge today. Perhaps God, we know, has invited you here today. And we are going to talk briefly about Nehemiah 3, but before we do that, I want to look at a couple of verses in Ephesians chapter 2. Because when God invites us, there are some things that happen. And I didn't give a heads up about this. So Ephesians 2, 8 through 10, thank you, James, says this. And these are well-known verses. Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 are very well-known. Verse 10 is a little less known, and that's what we're going to camp out on for a little while today. It says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God. Not a result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." So a few things that I absolutely love about verse 10 here. First of all, he says that we are God's workmanship. There's another word for workmanship that can actually sort of mean masterpiece, which would make sense because God's a perfect artist, he wouldn't make junk. So it's going to be a little awkward, especially if you're shy, but and I won't make you do it, but if you, I'm going to invite you to do this. Look at the person next to you and just say, you're God's masterpiece. Now, there's this interesting thing that happens in that. Whenever I think about being told that, I go, wait, like, no, not really. I don't feel like God's masterpiece. And then a masterpiece is usually set apart, right? Like there's only one perfect masterpiece. So how can everyone in this church, how can every child of God that's been saved by grace through faith be considered God's masterpiece, God's workmanship? Well, there is actually only one masterpiece, and his name is Jesus. And Jesus has seen fit to share all these good gifts with us. And then when he died on the cross in our place, he then ascended into heaven and then gave gifts to us. And some of those gifts are good works for us to do. It says that he prepared them beforehand for us to do. So Haiti team, when you went to Haiti a few weeks ago, you may not have known, it may not have been on your radar until later, but God knew and had planned and prepared beforehand for you to do these good works. Some of you are like, well, I've never gone on a mission trip, so maybe I don't have any good works. Yeah, you do. And God has prepared them for you in the way that you love your spouse, in the way that you love your children, in the way that you work with all of your heart. And God has called each person that's been adopted into his family through faith in Christ to do good works. And guess what? He plans them. We're just called to walk in them. So there's an invitation to all of us, walk in them and do this mission. Now, Nehemiah 3, and we will be brief here, and I will not read the whole chapter. If you have looked at Nehemiah 3, you know why I just said that. If you do a quick skim of Nehemiah 3, you're going to read lots of names of people and towns and places. And even though I have a biblical studies degree, an undergrad, and a seminary degree, I have no earthly idea how to pronounce a lot of these names. So rather than have you and I all struggle and suffer through that process, I'm going to highlight a few things and just read the first couple of verses, and then we're going to hand it over to the Haiti team to share with us. First of all, through this chapter, there's a few things to highlight. Nehemiah mentions 38 individual people by name in this passage. But he doesn't ever mention his own name in this chapter. There is something to that. That those that are leading are going to want to champion the team more than personal agenda and ego. Nehemiah's name is not mentioned in this chapter. Next, 38 individuals are mentioned. It's kind of like a roll call thing. Anybody ever had a teacher that went through rather lacklusterly usually? The role, it's like John, you go here, and then somebody mixes it up at some point after you hear about 10 here, somebody may say present, or someone may say yeah, and there's not a lot of enthusiasm in that, because though school is a great thing, and kids, school is a great thing, all right, it's not always the place that everybody wants to be. Sometimes students don't always want to be in school, and sometimes teachers don't always want to be in school. But when we've been invited by God into something, and we hear our name, there's a little bit of a different way in which we respond to say, here, present, I'm in the moment now, in this place. So God invited Nehemiah, or the author of this scripture here, to specifically mention 38 people by name. Not only are there 38 people by name, there are 42 groups of people mentioned in this passage. So you have 38 individuals and even more groups than just that. And the other number I want to give you guys is 52 days. That's how long it took them to build this wall. 52 days. That's not quite 2 months. Anybody ever done a home remodel project at their home before? Anybody ever even hired someone else to do a home remodel project? Does anything ever today get done in 52 days? It doesn't happen. How did this massive wall get built in 52 days? Nehemiah 3, verse 1 says, "Then Eliashib, the high priest, rose up with his brothers, the priests, and they built the sheep gate. They consecrated it and set its doors. They consecrated it as far as the Tower of the Hundred, as far as the Tower of Hinnom." And I'm going to stop there, because there is one word that is mentioned twice in this verse that I think does a lot to answer the question as to how you have 38 individuals, 42 groups, and in 52 days they accomplish the job. It's the word consecrated. They consecrated it to the Lord. Consecration means to set apart for holy use and purpose. And God has invited you and I to consecrate to Him our time, our talents, our treasure, our hearts, our minds, our souls, our lives to Him. And when we bow our knee to Him in consecration, He will do in 52 days what would take us 502 days. Like at this time, to invite the Haiti team to come up and share a little bit about what they experienced.
So you're not going to hear from me this morning, and I'm really excited about that, actually, because I think this team that we took to Haiti this year, I was blown away by their selflessness, their willingness, the teachableness, we're going to say that, teachableness of their hearts. On this trip, and just by the way, everybody just threw themselves in to what we were doing, and the whole time we're thinking about what it would look like for them to come back changed and transformed, to take what was learned, what was experienced that week, and apply it here at home. Because if you go on a mission trip and all you have to show for it are photos of you with kids who look different from you, and there's no transformation, then really it was a bit of a waste of a week. And our heart was that we would do something that was long-term, both in Haiti and when we came back here. And so it was the privilege of my life. It was the most unique. I've been to a lot of places with a lot of teams. It was, for me, incredibly special. And God moved in really unique ways. And I can say that it was, for me, the one of the most transformative weeks of my life. And so without saying anything further, I'm going to invite, there are going to be four who share this morning. And so the first one is going to be Diana. This was Diana's third trip to Haiti, and she's just going to share for a couple of minutes.
I first want to thank everybody because you were on mission with us. We appreciate your prayers, your donations, financial support. Without you, we couldn't have done it. So you were with us as we went. Each time I'm reminded I knew I wanted to go on the first mission trip. I didn't know God was calling me to the second and the third. But each time, you know, you think you're going to help somebody, and you don't. You help yourself. You may help, you may bless people. We don't know. We won't know until we get to heaven. But the beauty of it is he changes us. He changed us. He changed us all individually. As Eric said, we had an incredible team. So this week when I read the church email, and I'd been looking at Nehemiah 3, you know, I was so moved by it. But when I read the title, it says, "He Knows Your Name." Wow. He knows our name. How powerful is that? Each and every one of us he created, and he knows our names. I wept. I wept for Haiti, and I wept for everyone there as Jesus wept for us. I'm forever changed with each child I held, looking into their eyes, got to pray over them. I was blessed. The mother and her two children I met at an orphanage who led or found out, who we found out that was there to give up her children. A mom and a dad. Okay, so I wept, yes. A mom and a dad in City Soleil who let me hold their two-month-old child. I briefly got to adore and love and pray for that child, who then later through translation, I couldn't understand. They kept trying to tell me something and I couldn't. So Josette translated for me. They wanted me to take their baby home with them. The boy who wouldn't let me, who wouldn't look at me when I carried the bucket with him. I had the privilege to carry a bucket with this boy. I asked him his name. He wouldn't look at me. He wouldn't tell me. But in that brief moment, I was blessed because I know God has plans for him. The elderly people that we met who relied on their immediate family and their church. And over the 3 years, I got to know a couple of them or meet with them several times. What a blessing they were to us. And the people who serve there day in and day out, they have to put on their good face for all of us to come there, okay? And Eric encouraged us to serve them and really pay attention to love them. And that's what we did. We didn't know how we were serving or what we were doing, but each of us used our gifts, and that was such a great thing. So when I said that he knows your name, again, I'm forever changed. I may not remember their name, but to know how, but to know that when I pray for them, my Heavenly Father knows their name and loves them too. Knowing this is comforting and powerful. Luke 10:27 reminds us that we are called to love the Lord our God with all of our heart and with all of our soul and with all of our strength. And to love your neighbors as yourself. What I want to take away from this is my prayer that my Heavenly Father changes me and calls me to love deeper and to love others as Jesus loves me.
Thank you, Diana. And next is going to be Lori Kinder. This was Lori's first time coming with us to Haiti. And as she's walking up, just a note, I received about 3 emails from Healing Haiti after I got back saying that the Haitian staff there didn't want our team to leave because they were so blessed by the way that this team loved them. So that brought extraordinary joy to my heart. I just wanted to brag on them a little bit in God's grace. Okay.
You are about to witness a vast difference between a professional Diana Johnson and a first-timer, right here. That's awesome. Immeasurably more. Erica said this was on her heart as she prayed for our group before we left. She felt that we were all going to see immeasurably more than we could all realize, and I believed it. But then, as the trip got closer, as we do sometimes, we start thinking in depth about it, questioning it, and wondering how it will apply to my life. What will I see immeasurably more of? What will I be able to interpret as immeasurably more? What will I get out of this? God put on my heart that I was going to Haiti several years ago, before I even started attending the Bridge. But I always found a way not to go. My job, my kids, my mom, my whatever. This year I committed to going, and 2 weeks before we were to leave, I found 4 new reasons not to go. My work, my mom, my husband, and fear of germs. I know, I didn't even know this about myself, really. But as God cleared the way and told me to leave it up to him, I listened, and I ended up going. As I struggled with why I was there, I asked myself, what can I possibly do to help the Haiti situation? God looked down on me and said, "You are funny. You make me laugh." And he started laying it out for me. As I constantly heard the message, "We are not here to fix. We are here to show God's children what God's kingdom on earth can look like," I slowly started getting my answers. After the first day of visiting an orphanage and seeing the children and seeing that they had a building stopped in mid-construction, I became frustrated again, thinking, why can't we just give them money or just help finish this building? Why? So we could walk away and say that this is what we did while we were there. This is why I went to Haiti, and this is what we did, and now we are done. But I soon realized that this is exactly what we weren't there to do, because that act would satisfy my need, not Haiti's need. God has a different plan. Now I can say this is what we did, and then when the people I talk to ask me the same questions I ask myself, I can spread God's word and show them a glimpse of the kingdom on earth and not make it about me and what I did. As it unfolded, I was amazed at not what I was being taught, but more at what my limits were in my own mind. As I sat in the round area at the orphanage, I watched a little boy mirror the exact same gestures that Karen did to the little girl she was holding that was actually up in the video. He looked in her eyes, he touched her face, and he touched and held her hand. I then understood what it was that we were doing there. A finished building or extra money could never convey what a kind act of compassion could convey in 3 seconds. I was overwhelmed with understanding. My immeasurably more became stepping out of my comfort zone, acting with the Holy Spirit, feeling closer to God through prayer, washing a beautiful woman's feet as if they were Jesus' feet, having the words to talk to people about what we did in Haiti. I was covered while away. I was doing exactly what I was supposed to be doing.
All right, and next we have Tommy McBee, and this was also Tommy's first time to Haiti.
Hello, everyone. I want to start by saying that I am terrified of public speaking, so bear with me, and I'm unprepared. So I don't have anything written down. I'm just going to talk to you guys. this trip to Haiti this year was something I felt God calling me to. Didn't really know why, just knew that it was clear that he wanted me to go. Let Erica know, hey, I want to go to Haiti. And, everybody was excited, and we just kind of moved forward with it, and it all worked out. And I kind of had like an idea of what it was going to be like based on stories that I had heard from, people who have been before. But I quickly realized when we got there, I was a bit off. Haiti is beautiful. Paradise on earth, really, if I could explain it. And it's just, at the same time, heartbreaking to see a lot of what we saw there. So as we went throughout the week, God just started to work on me and started to kind of reveal to me why I was there, and it wasn't just to serve the Haitian people. There was a lot of people that I went with on this trip that just made a tremendous impact on my life. I fell in love with every person that we went with. And I can't say enough about our team and who they are and the people that they are. But as we went throughout the week, there was a verse or some verses that hit me really hard while I was there. And it was kind of God working because it was just happened to be where I was reading through scripture in my daily devotional. And I just kind of stumbled across it like second or third day there. But I'm going to read it to you guys. For I was hungry and you gave me food, and I was thirsty and you gave me drink. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. I was naked and you clothed me. I was sick and you visited me. I was in prison and you came to me. Then the righteous will answer to him, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick and in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, you did it to me. That hit me really hard because I realized that we were going out to serve people that had genuine, real needs. And much of the world sees these people as insignificant. But what God hit me really hard was is that these people are beautiful. And they have so many things about them that I admire and that I wish I was more like them.
Right, and last but certainly not least, we have Karen LeBoux, and this was Karen's second trip to Haiti. And Karen's going to explain why there's a bucket on the stage, in case you were wondering.
Well, last year was amazing, and I didn't think it could be any better than last year, but there was something that God did. It was the immeasurably more. It was the group for me that really changed me. And I can say that this is the first time I've ever spoke to a group where you're nervous, that I don't feel alone. I feel like every person, a part of the team, is with me. And so I want to try to just in a few minutes share with you what we experienced. It was really simple. We ate. We played games together. We had great laughter. We had things break open in us that caused us to cry and break down. We experienced sadness. We slept in the same place. Just simple things like that, the spending of time and Erica sharing about the kingdom of God. We started living the kingdom of God together. We were generous with each other. We showed physical affection. We gave massages to each other that just kind of multiplied. We just had so much fun together. And then we got to go out and we got to take on the challenge of trying to, from our empty places, show the love of Jesus that we knew we didn't know how to do. And so in City Soleil, everyone lines up behind the water truck, and we did this 2 days with their buckets. But their buckets are cracked, and they're dirty, and they're broken. And when I came home, my husband brought in a bucket that he had gotten, and it was such a contrast to what we were so familiar. This is an American bucket, and there's no cracks in it, but there's something amazing about Haiti, in that when you go there, oh, it's beautiful, but it's a broken country. The people are broken, but they know the love of God in the most powerful way, because their brokenness has room for God to fill them. And I think that's what we learned. I think we went with our buckets, seeing that we had something to give, but then I think we found ourselves experiencing every morning bringing our broken buckets to God, empty, with the challenge to go out and do something that we couldn't do on our own. And together, we did. We would walk into an orphanage, and everyone would just do what they desired to do. Jump rope, guitar, massage, sitting with kids, holding kids. And we got our buckets filled not only by giving and serving, but by being together. We could look around and see everyone in our group giving us strength, and we were sharing such a love. That's something that I think this group has even stronger of a desire to serve together as a group in Alton. And that simply looks like spending time. This week I had coffee with people, and through the spending time, we had conversations about what we could do in Alton and dreaming about how we could serve together. I just want to encourage you in that serving and doing something that's so challenging is is the most wonderful things you could do. It gives you great meaning, and it gives you a thirst to just have God continually empty your bucket, to have him fill it, to be able to empty it again. So we're really grateful we got to go.
So I hope what you heard through them sharing this morning, and Stephen's going to come up and finish his sermon or give his sermon, but is that not everyone here will be called to go to Haiti or called to the ends of the earth. We're all called to support those things. But what we all are all called to do is to build the wall, or in this case, build the kingdom, bring the kingdom of God to earth. And so for us, as we come back from Haiti, what that does is just, it allows us to dream big. It allows us to see what God is capable of doing, and then desire and crave that for here. Desire and crave that for Alton. Desire and crave that for our country, where Christianity in many places is on the decline in the Western world and in the developing world. In places like Haiti, it's on the rise because they understand their need and their dependence on a Savior. And so as Stephen comes, just know if you're called to come to Haiti with us next year, you know I would love to have you. I would love it. If you need a kickstart, come. But don't wait for that. Like, go out tomorrow and build his kingdom and experience the fullness and the joy of what it's like to know your role in his story.
Well, in many ways, the sermon was already preached. Thank you, Haiti team. Thank you, Erica, for leading them. Thank you, church, for praying and sending them. But we are sent out by not just a church, not just a people. We're sent out by Jesus. Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations. This good news of great joy. And it can happen in Haiti, as you heard, and it can happen next door. And it can happen within your home. And it is happening within those places. And we have been invited in to that. I have four very brief points. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to prepare for communion, because I've got kind of a something I want everyone to kind of wrestle with before we move into communion as well. Father, thank you so much for what you've done through this service. Thank you for your grace that reigns in our lives, and help us, God, to know how to hear you, how to listen to you, how to see you, how to love you, and how to walk with you today and every day. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's a lot of study in chapter 3 that you can do, but I have one question. How did they build the wall? And how do we build the kingdom? So how did they build the wall? There's actually some really simple, practical things that they did, okay? They didn't use magic stones, okay? They used normal stones, but I'm not really talking so much about how they built it, more so what motivated the build. How did they do what they were called to do? And the first thing is, they recognized that they were building for the king. That this was not some project that they did because they thought it would spruce up their city. This is something that they were convinced the King of Kings had summoned them to do and invited them into. So Colossians 3, 23 and 24, which I read on Monday afternoon at a funeral for a man that lived this out and what he sought to say and do. It says this, Colossians 3, 23 and 24. Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. So how might that change things? Let's take a really simple, practical example. How does it change things if you wash the dishes for the Lord? How does it change things if you help your child with their homework for the Lord? How does it change things if you work at your job not for your boss or clock in or clock out, but as heartily for the Lord? These 38 individuals and 42 different groups of people were motivated by a higher king and a higher principle. And as part of building the kingdom, that's part of what we're called to do as well. So first of all, they realized they were building for the king. Secondly, they realized that they were not just building a wall, that there was more at work and more at stake with what they did. So there's a story some of you know that goes like this. A man came across three masons who were working at shipping chunks of granite from large blocks. The first seemed unhappy at his job, chipping away and frequently looking at his watch. When the man asked what it was that he was doing, the first mason responded, "I'm hammering this stupid rock and can't wait till 5 when I can go home." A second mason, seemingly more interested in his work, was hammering diligently, and when asked what it was he was doing, answered, "Well, I'm molding this block of rock so that it can be used with others to construct a wall. It's not bad work, but I'll sure be glad when it's done." The third mason was hammering at his block fervently, taking time to stand back and admire his work. He chipped off small pieces until he was satisfied that it was the best he could do. When he was questioned about his work, he stopped, gazed skyward, and proudly proclaimed, "I am building a cathedral." Three men, three different attitudes, all doing the same job. These 38 men and 42 groups, they weren't just building a wall. They were building the kingdom. So as you work for the king, doing dishes and helping your children and working at your job, you're not just working at a job. You're not just making dishes clean, and you're not just helping your children with homework. You're building the kingdom for the king. Now, in the midst of the daily grind and in the midst of stress, the temptation will be, I always have more to do. I don't have time to step back and stop and watch the king build his kingdom through you. Shut that out of your mouth and mind. Pause. Stop. Be in awe. Enjoy the sunrises and sunsets. Treasure the moments you have with your children. Thank God for the job that he's given to you. And watch the dishes shine. They will eventually. Take glory in the little things as you build for the king his kingdom. Third, they built it together. I'm not going to get bogged down in all the details, but 38 different people. Have you ever tried to do a group project with just four people? And then on top of the 38 different people, compound it by 42 different groups. Some of these groups coming from far away, and some of them close. Some of them feeling like they have been in Jerusalem longer and are somehow more loyal, and others that are the newbies in town. The group dynamics, the challenge, the differences of opinion, the egos. But they built together. They saw the big picture. They recognized the big mission. So you have, just to name a few, merchants and goldsmiths, priests, dads and daughters. Love that section. It's a dad with his daughters working, building. And here's the one that just baffles me. I didn't know there was such a thing in Nehemiah's day. Perfumers. Perfumers are mentioned building a wall. They probably smelled the best out of everybody building. But when do you see a builder take up like a hammer and build a wall? Which should say something to us. Sometimes we feel like we'll only do what we're experienced and skilled and qualified to do. It does not work in the Bible, and it doesn't work in the kingdom of God. You're called to do what the king tells you to do. And when you tell the king, I didn't study this, I don't know what I'm doing, the king will, I love what Lori Kinder said, laugh at you and go, no, Ron, I'm the king. I'll empower you to do what I call you to do. So a perfumer now on his resume can write, I built the wall of Jerusalem. This is the part of the wall that I built. And finally, we build where we are. There's sections here where it says, they built across from their home. They built where they lived. Now, this does not disqualify or discount going to Haiti. We have evidence of that in this chapter too, because there are people going from towns further away to come in to help. But you've got to build where you are. When I was in college, there was a fellow student that felt like God was calling him to international mission work. And there was a professor that all of us admired that we all wanted to like spend time with because he really knew the Bible and we admired that. And this guy went and sat down with the professor and said, I'm called to international missions. And the professor said, wonderful. What are you doing on the campus? And the man said, well, I'm waiting, I'm preparing. Okay. Who are you sharing the love of Christ with on the campus? Who are you in community group with, where you're at? How are you building the kingdom here and now where you are? There's comfort, there's hope, there's joy in that, because it means we can walk out this door. In fact, we don't even have to walk out the door before you can engage with someone else in this church today and build the kingdom and encourage them and share with them the love of Christ. So how did they build the wall in 52 days, 38 individuals, 42 different groups? It was consecrated. It was commanded by the king. They recognized they weren't just building a wall. But ultimately, they did the next logical thing. We're going to prepare to take communion in a few moments, and I have there's a man that I love in our congregation that always shares with me, you don't give me enough time before preparing for communion. I feel like I need to get my heart ready. I feel like I need to pause. I need to make sure that I've got ample time to prepare my heart. So this is ample time to prepare your heart. But I want you to look at this here. Jesus, the king, has invited you to a table to eat, to drink, although we dip. That's confusing. You would take the bread, you dip it in the cup. Jesus has invited you to a meal. But Jesus has also pre-planned for you good works to do. What are those good works? And that's what I want you to think about, that by his grace, you've been washed, your slate has been wiped clean by the blood of Jesus, and now you're invited in to do these good works. And some of you, you may be thinking too big and broad in general. So Elizabeth Elliot popularized an old poem, and I don't even know who wrote it, I don't know when it was written, but it's Do the Next Thing. And this is what it says. From an old English parsonage down by the sea, there came in the twilight a message to me. Its quaint Saxon legend, deeply engraven, hath, it seemed to me, teaching from heaven. And on through the doors the quiet words ring, like a low inspiration, do the next thing. Many a questioning, many a fear, many a doubt, hath its quieting here. Moment by moment let down from heaven, time, opportunity, and guidance are given. Fear not tomorrow's child of the king. Trust them with Jesus. Do the next thing. Do it immediately. Do it with prayer. Do it reliantly, casting all care. Do it with reverence, tracing his hand, who placed it before thee with earnest command. Stayed on omnipotence, safe neath his wing, weave all results, do the next thing. Looking for Jesus, ever serener, working or suffering, be thy demeanor. In his dear presence, the rest of his calm, the light of his countenance, be thy psalm. Strong in his faithfulness, praise and sing. Then as he beckons thee, do the next thing. May God grant us the gift of doing the next thing for the King, for his kingdom, together, right where we are. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the grace you give us to save us, to rescue us, to build us, that your kingdom may come on earth as it is in heaven. Father, I pray for each person here that their mind and heart may be moved by your Spirit, that you would reveal to them what that next thing is they're called to do. And then when they do that, to do the next thing, and the next thing, and the next thing, for the joy that's set before him. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Karen, when she shared, said, I'm going to talk to you about what we did. What we did was pretty simple. And then she said the first thing, we ate. There's something about it, isn't there? Just eating. And there's going to be food in heaven. There's going to be a big banquet. And I think at that banquet, Jesus is going to invite us who trust him, who know him, who've been saved by his grace to the table. There's going to be a chair at this big banquet for you to sit in. And as you sit in this banquet, Jesus, I think, is going to smile. He's going to be the host. He's going to be the one serving the food. But he's going to share with you and I about all those divine appointments, all of those God-given experiences, all of those times he called us to build together. The king is not done calling his people to build. We talked a little bit about Alton this week, why it's in the decline in so many ways. And there's one word that came, someone said, who actually was also on the Haiti team. It's the word hope. That there's a lack of hope. Jesus fills us with hope. And the Bible describes the hope he gives as a living hope. Because Jesus died, but didn't stay dead. He rose from the dead. And he said, as often as you remember that this bread was broken for you, just like his body was broken for you, as often as you take the cup, and remember that his blood was shed for you, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. There's that living hope. I'm inviting you to a meal, to a table, but I'm also coming again. And then we will eat forever and ever together. Until that day comes, do the next thing. Just keep doing the next thing.
Stephen mentioned hope a few minutes ago, and I read something this week that struck me. And as we get ready to sing this last song, which is All I Have is Christ, I wanted to share it with you. In 2015, nearly one-third of students in grades 9 through 12 reported feeling hopeless or sad almost every day for an extended period in the last year. That's in the United States. 30%. That's extraordinary levels of hopelessness. And the direct response to that is the love of Christ. Because it's the only thing that gives us purpose. It's the only thing that gives us meaning. Because we were created with like this God-sized hole in our souls. And only He can fill and fulfill those things. And so as we get ready to sing All I Have is Christ, I just want to read Ephesians 5:14 says this. This is why it is said, "Wake up, sleeper, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." My prayer is just that we would leave today awoken, I guess. Woken, or with our souls awakened, I guess is the right word. Awakened to the purpose for which we were created, which is knowing God, loving Him fully, and building His kingdom, and loving others in the way that we've been loved. And so we're going to sing this song. This is the first time we've sung this at the bridge, but the chorus is just, "Hallelujah, all I have is Christ. Hallelujah, Jesus is my life." And I would just encourage you, as these words come up on the screen, this is a powerful declaration. It's a powerful prayer for us to go out with. And so even if you've never heard this song, we invite you to sing it with us and to sing it out, even if you don't know the notes. And it's a pretty catchy tune, so I think you'll catch on pretty quickly. But if you'll go ahead and stand, let's pray together, and then we're going to sing this song. Father, may we sing this song with honest and genuine hearts. Father, may we declare all we have is Christ. May we actually believe it. And where we don't, we pray that You would fill in our unbelief with belief, Lord. We pray that as we sing these words, that You would make them true, that You would make them real for us, Lord. I pray that we would be Your light, that we would be an antidote to hopelessness, that we would bring light to the darkness. And as we do it, Lord, that we wouldn't do it in our own power or in our own strength or hold ourselves up as messiahs and saviors, but Father, that we would point to You, because it's Jesus who's the Savior and Messiah and who brings hope and who brings life and who gives it to the fullest. And so, Father, we give this to You now. And it's in Jesus' name that we ask these things and that we're going to sing this song. Amen.
Was lost in darkest night, yet though I knew the way, the sin that promised joy and life had led me to the grave. I had no hope that You would own a rebel to first, I would refuse You still. Hallelujah, all I have is Christ. Hallelujah.
I ran my hellbound race, indifferent to the cost. You looked upon my helpless state and led me to the cross. And I beheld God's love displayed. You suffered in my place. You bore the wrath reserved for me. And all I know is grace. Hallelujah. All I have is Christ. Hallelujah. Jesus is my life. Now, Lord, I would be yours alone and live so all might see the strength to follow your commands could never come from me. For Father, use my ransom life.
Can't sing that song without the tears streaming down. The King's calling, and He's all we have. In the midst of all the other blessings, all the other joys, the King is the only one that stays. And He calls. And He speaks to your brokenness, the American bucket. What a fraud. We're all broken. And then the King comes. And He speaks and He heals. And He reminds us all we have is Him. And He is enough. So let's go out and do the next thing. Receiving a benediction is a powerful thing because it's pretty much saying, my hands are open to receive what only you can give. Let's really receive this today. And now, God, to you, may you cause your face to shine upon us. May we see your countenance. May you give us peace. And may you empower us to go out and do the next thing. Because the King calls. And the kingdom is being built on earth as it is in heaven. Until the day you come again. May you go. May we go out, God, with hope. With a living hope. Amen.